So for the folks who are here, we're so fortunate to have you join us for Reed College Faculty Spotlight. This is an event that we host annually around this time of year that's really for some of your admitted students, some of your even juniors who decide to come and spend some time with us. And as you know, we're going to have a lot of programming throughout the year, all the way through May 1st. And for you seniors, particularly for you admitted seniors, this is really designed for you to get a great feel of what it'd be like in the Reed community. We've got three of our faculty here, and they're just going to share with you their life on campus. We're going to talk a little about their major programs. And after we do introductions, I'm going to go through how this day will work in terms of me taking questions and responding to folks. And so let's go in alphabetical order by first name. And we'll do some introductions. If I could have our faculty members let us know what department you represent, what your name is, of course, and also tell us a little bit about your area of emphasis within the program. I think that's super interesting to find out, you know, what exactly for your discipline you spend a lot of time thinking about. And so I think that means you're first, Erica.
Yes, I think you're right. I'm Erica Blum. I use she, her pronouns. It's lovely to see so many folks attending today. I am a faculty member in the computer science department, and within computer science, my area of specialty is cryptography and with a touch of distributed computing. So what happens when we get a whole bunch of computers, cell phones, devices, servers all talking to each other? And maybe some of those devices are have a bug or have some sort of fault. What happens next? How do we make sure that one bad apple doesn't spoil the whole big multi-million dollar system? So that's the sort of thing I like to study.
Great. Thanks, Erica. Fatima, I think you're next.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Fathimath Mustaq. I'm in the political science department. I mainly teach political economy. I like to study things like global finance, climate finance, development finance. Right now, I'm working on several different projects. One of them is my book, which focuses on central banking in the global south, looking at countries like India, and reaching as far back as colonial legacies to think about how the coalitions, political, economic coalitions formed during those times, shape how central banking is done today, right? So that's one part of the research that I do. I also do a lot of work on climate finance, and I have some students working with me at the moment as well. So that's really exciting. Yeah, I'll leave it at that.
Thanks, Fatima. And Kris, how about you?
Hi, Kris Anderson. I'm from the psychology department. I'm a clinical psychologist by training, and my area of specialization is what we call developmental psychopathology. So when we look at development of life across the life course, where do we see people come into periods of poor mental health and wellness? And my primary focus is looking at the developmental psychopathology of addictive behaviors from the ages of 10 to 25. But I also do quite a bit of work on gender, particularly people who identify as women. And I have a sideline of research on women athletes, broadly defined as women.
Thank you, Kris. Well, thank you all so much for spending some time with us. Again, for our guests, the way this will work is, as you see, this is different from some of our other sessions in which you may have participated. We've got the Q&A feature active. And so if you have any questions throughout the session, if there are things you want to know, go ahead and type it in throughout the event just for me to track it. I'm going to be dismissing those and sort of putting it in a holding pattern so I can ask the questions over the course of the day. Some of your questions I'm going to combine with what other folks want to know. I know I won't be able to get to all of them, but I'm going to get to as many as possible. And so feel free to jump on in. Also, reminder, we will have department-specific sessions in April. So if you're looking for an online session where we're just talking about political science, just talking about psychology, just talking about computer science or psychology, you can join those sessions, and those will be much more in-depth in terms of the curriculum, what courses you take, what majors you have. We'll touch on some of that stuff right now, But I just wanted to give you a sense of what it's going to be like interacting and working with the faculty here. So faculty, I'm going to ask you sort of the first question. And so this is, you know, people talk a lot. When you talk to your colleagues at a conference, when you talk to them, you know, doing research and maybe do a lot of social media, and they say, so what's it like working at Reed? What's it like being in the Reed community? What do you tell them? How do you respond to that?
I can take that. That's a great question. So because I do a lot of work in kind of a biomedical and psychosocial field, I'm the only person that I know of at my conference from a small liberal arts college. Everybody else are at large research institutions or medical centers, and I've worked there before I came here. So everybody's kind of curious, like, what is it like to be a small liberal arts college? And I typically say it's an absolute gas. It's a lot of fun because I get to play with people who are really curious, and that students, you know, students ask questions that I've forgotten to ask about my field, if that makes sense. You know, once you've been working in a field for a long time, you have these things that you just assume are true because they're foundational and you learned them a long time ago. And so what I really enjoy is my students come in and they're new to the field, and they sometimes identify things that should, that to them are self-evident. Why don't you do X? And it often makes me kind of stop and think and say, well, that's a great question. Why do we do it? And so yeah, I use the example, one of my very first thesis students a long time ago said, hey, everybody's studying these reasons why you drink. Why aren't people studying reasons why we don't drink? So that's a great question. And it kicked off 10 years of research in my laboratory. And so that's why I just enjoy it. You know, it's this really kind of dynamic and exciting intellectual experience.
Thanks, Chris.
I would echo Chris as well. I have found teaching at Reed to be really wonderful experience, precisely because of the relationships we get to cultivate with our students. So we have, you know, the small conferences, which are capped at 24, which means that you get to create a real sense of community in the classroom. So I like to have 3-hour classes at Reed, and we get to really dive into, you know, different topics. And, you know, we usually have a coffee break in the middle, and it's a real learning community, right? Like, students are drawing on the board, like working out causal mechanisms, debating with one another. It's a real intellectual community. Another thing I really love about Reed is the thesis process. I mean, the kind of projects, you know, students propose are amazing, right? Some of them go into field work, they go through the rigorous IRB process. I've had, you know, 2 students go into field work, come back with really, you know, wonderful data interviews. And so just working with students through the research process, seeing kind of their intellect, like how they develop intellectually. These are really wonderful things we have at Reed. And I think it's really only possible at a small liberal arts college.
So Fathimath, you mentioned the senior thesis. Can you tell folks what that is?
Yeah, so every senior at Reed has to write a thesis. This wasn't the case when I went to college, right? So I went to a small liberal arts college as well, and they selected a few students to write a thesis, but at Reed, every senior gets to write one, which I think is wonderful, right? You get to kind of pick a topic that really interests you, find a faculty member who can guide you, and you get to really create this research project, right? You, with your faculty member, you can refine your question and then develop kind of a research proposal, right? Think about, you know, what are the concepts you'll engage with? Think about, you know, if you're doing a social science piece of work, like what are the causal mechanisms you're interested in? What are the hypotheses? And then you come up with a research methodology, right? And then, as I said, some of our students go into the field. Some of them just get data off of the internet, right? Or rely on secondary literature. And then through this year-long process, you create this wonderful piece of original work, right? And it's yours, right? And it's wonderful. I mean, the kind of the culmination of all of this is like the orals process, where you get the, you know, you're in a room with 3 other faculty members and with the advisor, and yeah, they ask you questions and you are the expert in the room, right? Because
mm-hmm.
you are the one who knows the most about that topic. And it's a really, I found that it's, you know, for students, it's a time for them to shine. And it's a great way to kind of wrap up the Reed College experience.
I always say it's, is it something that people equally look forward to or equally dread? But once you get there, you figure out a way. I mean, it's wonderful to see people really own what they create. I think that's one of the special pieces about our senior thesis. I have a few more questions that I'd love to ask all of you about the senior thesis, but before I move to that, Erica, how about you?
Yeah, so sorry, just to clarify, looping back to our earlier question about what I love about teaching at Reed or about what the senior thesis is like, or maybe both.
what you love teaching about Reed.
Sure, so I think to echo a lot of what Kris and Fatima already mentioned, like talking to my colleagues at large schools where a normal class might have 400 students in it, it feels like honestly such a luxury to get to have classes of 20 students that I can form that one-on-one connection with and not to be thinking like, okay, how am I going to present this idea to a sort of big crowd of folks, but to individuals who I know and get to know and know what will engage them. That just honestly, I feel like luxury is the right word for it. I feel really lucky that I can work in that mode compared to what I know some of my colleagues are doing. So,
so here's, you know, just sort of frank conversation about senior thesis. You know, it's sort of interesting. So I imagine that some people might look at this project and think, oh my gosh, that's just crazy overwhelming. You know, how do you expect me to do something for a year long, you know, research? And we talk about, you know, every senior thesis goes in the thesis tower. You can look at every student who's ever gone to Reed and pull down their thesis. I mean, is that anxiety that people have about this? Is that appropriate? I mean, how do people wrap their head around it when they get to senior and they have to defend it in front of faculty and, you know, some other person they've chosen to talk about their project with?
Well, I mean, the thing is, you don't start with thesis, right? You end with thesis, right? I mean,
yeah.
Our curriculum is really designed to get students ready for thesis. And so every step of the way from your introductory level curriculum to what you take kind of your core courses and your qualifying exam, I mean, this is the culmination of 4 years of preparation or 3 years of preparation. And it's a collaborative project. I think, you know, I think it seems daunting if you think you're gonna write this huge thing over a year, but, you know, very much when I work with my thesis students, I've known them for years, right?
Yeah.
They've taken classes with me and my colleagues. We socialize together in departmental events. We go to talks together. So it's not, you know, we have a kind of, I hope, a trusting relationship by that point. And very much I treat my students like a research collaborator. You know, we talk about, here's what I'm good at as a mentor. What are your interests? Where do they dovetail? You bring ideas to me and I help you guide through that process. So you're not left alone. You know, I see my thesis students twice a week. I have a lab meeting with all my thesis students together. And then I meet with everybody individually a half hour, if not an hour, depending on what we're working on. It's not handholding. It is just kind of working with a more senior colleague on the project. So, you know, that I can help them with that anxiety. And I tell my students, like, if I'm doing my job, you should feel like the process is like this all year, and it shouldn't feel overwhelming, and it shouldn't feel anxiety provoking. And I think most of the time we're just excited about it. You know, it's like, look at this cool thing. I mean, today I spent longer than I should have, an hour and a half. It was supposed to be a 45-minute meeting because we were running analyses, and it was like, wow, look at this cool thing that came in your data. Wait, let's ask this other question, you know? So I think that helps. I don't know if that answers your question, Milyon, but I think it helps when it's a culmination and it's a collaborative work, and it's fun. It's not, you know, to me, it's fun.
No, I think that hits right along the threads because we talk about all this is, you know, graduate level research and, you know, everything we say about it could sort of, you know, seem like it's fraught with landmines, but it really is. By the time you get there, it all makes sense. and you're partnering with this faculty member on this journey. And so what I always challenge students to do is imagine your capability your senior year at Reed. I tell people, don't think about your first year at Reed, think about your fourth year at Reed. Who you're gonna be, what you're gonna be able to do, because that first year sounds really exciting and fun. Where am I gonna live? Am I gonna hang out? But if you really like that senior year version of you at Reed more than you like the senior year version of you somewhere else, this might be the place you wanna be in. Kris, I think you spoke to just that.
Well, and it's not like any of the students who are sitting in the audience right now are who they were as freshmen in high school, right? Yeah. They've made huge gains, you know, intellectually, socially. That's the same process that happens in college. You know, you just have a different set of partners to do it with in a different environment.
I'm going to ask a couple of questions that have been put out for us. Let's see, kind of combine two about computer science, Erica. And then one about psychology. So if we, let me sort of summarize both of these. Can you talk about the type of research students might do in computer science and why that research might be helpful for them in terms of their preparation for life after Reed?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think it looks like a lot of different things. So I'm trying to sort of organize my thoughts on where to start. And I think even within what I would call my lab, it can look very different as far as things that might lie more on the experimental end of the spectrum versus a more theoretical end of the spectrum. So my area is of choice is in cryptography, which has a lot of mathematical foundations as well as a lot of applications in computer science. And so for the most part, when I was talking to folks about what equipment I needed to get set up here, I said, well, a chalkboard would be great. Maybe some paper and pencils, I'll be happy. I do a lot of math. So I have students who are working on sort of more mathematical ideas, like how does the underlying mathematics in an encryption system work or in a digital signature scheme. And then on the other sort of end of the spectrum, I have some thesis students I'm working with where our day-to-day looks a lot more like writing code for us to build a system that we want to study the performance of, things like that. And I know that's sort of the span of things just within my little bubble, and it gets much wider as you include my other colleagues in the computer science department as well. Mm-hmm. And I think really what I'm hoping that thesis students and really anyone who does research with me, whether that's like over the summer or an independent study project or a thesis, is to learn sort of this systematic way that we approach scientific inquiry, right? So how to formalize something new, that how to put into words something that you don't understand or don't know yet in enough detail to be able to go probe it and study it and try to shed some light on it. So just having them see the process of trying to probe at the edges of what you understand to find something new that you can do there. And that's a new and different and sometimes a little scary way of thinking when up until that point, there has been like a right answer that your professor could give you. And so sometimes the students I'm working with will look at me like, well, is that right or not? And I'm like, I don't know, we got to figure that out. And I think to me, that's really what's so delightful about it. And I think they feel that too. So mm-hmm. I hope that students take out of a research experience with me, first and foremost, is just being able to tackle a problem that they haven't seen before in a systematic way and with confidence and gusto, even though it's not something they've done that exact thing before.
Interestingly enough, I think that also in some ways connects to our grading system, this sort of idea of learning where, you know, as I explained to folks, you don't receive your grade, but you do get a grade, but the focus is really on what you've learned how you've acquired that knowledge, what you're thinking. Discovery, if this is right or wrong, it really changes your relationship with learning. When I got a grade, I just didn't have to think about that assignment anymore. I sort of threw it away. And I think here at Reed, you know, that the grade is always the end of a conversation when that conversation should actually continue. And, you know, I also tell students, if you want your grade, you can request it. They might say, why do you want your grade? And you're like, I want to know how I'm doing. Your faculty member might say, okay, let's sit down and talk about how you're doing. It's a different muscle that, you know, your first year is really hard to think about, but by the time you're a sophomore, you can't think of it any other way. Can you all talk a little bit about, a little bit more about our grading policy? What do you think it does for students? How you might approach it? Fatima, I might have you start.
Yeah, At first I was very skeptical of the policy because I've never not known my grades, right? But by the end of the first semester, I was like, wow, this really actually works. And on my side, from my side, I think what it forces me to do as a teacher is to really explain to the students, right, why I'm giving them that grade, right, which they are not going to see, but I'm like, okay, like, what are the justifications? So I think the feedback that students get with this policy is much better and more comprehensive, so that you actually have something to look at and work off of on your next paper, right? Mm-hmm. So I think the feedback element is very strong with this policy, which is one thing that I really like about it. And then the second thing I like about it is that I get to actually see my students more often. I mean, I don't have a counterfactual to this, but I think I get more FaceTime with my students. They come and see me, right? We also, in addition to the grading policy, we also give quite a lot of feedback to students. We have like 4-week write feedbacks, 8-week feedback. So I have students who I advise, right, and also students in my class, and you get to check in with them, right, with the feedback that they get from other professors. And so I think you also get to have more face time with students, which is really great for cultivating those relationships.
Yeah, I would say for me, I mean, to me, it's about the process. It's not about the product as much. You know, I think the focus, is really on how do I create a growth medium for my students? I can't make anyone grow, but I can create an environment where people can afford themselves that opportunity. And so the kind of feedback that I'm trying to give is growth-oriented feedback, right? And so that doesn't, like, to grade to me is just, there's some criterion and people have attained it, you know, in a traditional institution. And here I'm very much trying to figure out what is the feedback that I can provide that individual for them to grow. And so often a lot of my courses I'll do have students create their learning goals at the beginning of the term on a note card, and I just throw it in my office and they don't see it until the end. And I give it back and I say, write a reflection paper for your final paper on what your initial goals were and what did you learn and what would you do in the next course based on what you've learned from this experience. And that's actually, for me, outside of the content, is some of the most, I think, beneficial for me as a teacher and for the students in feedback to kind of reflect, like, what did I do? What did I learn? What is my feedback to them about what I've seen them grow and do? And I think to me, that's more important. You know, it certainly conveys more than a letter grade anywhere. And certainly our students need the letter grades because a lot of our students do choose to go on to graduate school. So I don't want to ignore that piece. But I think it's just so de-emphasized, you know, that it makes me work harder, honestly. I don't know how you guys feel about it, but I feel like it's a heck of a lot harder to give you feedback on how you grow as a person and as a learner than it is to just say, C, B, A. But that's what we're dedicated to, right? That's why we're here.
You have to think of something thoughtful, meaningful to say so people actually continue to develop. B is kind of losing a little bit. We've had actually two different versions of this question. So if Reed were a movie, what movie would Reed be?
Oh, no.
Yes, we've nailed it. Erica, your physical reaction to slightly turn away from the camera was probably the best. And I'll chat a little bit before we get there, because there's a couple of questions I can answer while you think on that. if you received a renewable scholarship maintaining a 3.0, you know, with a different grade system, how do you actually determine if you have that? We'll let you know well before. So we talked about sort of the 4-week, 10-week notification, where if you aren't doing as competitively as you can, we actually will intercede. So it's not a surprise. And at the end of the day, our goal is to help you succeed. So this is not a place that's trying to trick you into falling below a bar that's gonna be detrimental to your financial health in terms of renewing scholarship. And if you do fall below a certain bar, as with most schools, the financial support does not disappear. We give you a lot of time to improve. We help provide resources for that. Your faculty are brought into this conversation. So it's not something that you'll be surprised at or that I think you'll need to worry about. All right, I won't have you all answer at once. I'll have one person answer, then we'll talk a little bit, then we'll have another person answer. But who wants to go first?
I thought of an answer. Should I go? Because I thought.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah.
I think it's Disney's Fantasia.
Whoa. Tell me more about that.
Yeah. So if those of you have seen Disney's Fantasia, it's a very old film, but it's orchestrated, and it's Mickey Mouse as the wizard who is kind of animating, dancing brooms and flying objects and colors. And it's sort of this phantasmagoria of experience. And I think that speaks to Reed for me in many ways. In that there's just so many opportunities for just unusual things to happen in this really organic way. And some of them are sort of like dancing pails and buckets. Like one of my favorite Reed stories is in my office, I sit out and I look out over a walkway in a parking lot. And one day I heard this bagpipe sound and it was like getting louder, you know, the redshift of sound, it's getting closer and closer and getting louder. I'm like, where is that coming from? And someone goes by me, a student at the time, on a unicycle playing bagpipes. And he's heading to the art department. And the sound then gets, you know, farther away. And there's another student who 5 seconds later is chasing after them with a camera, right? And then all of a sudden they turn around and the sound gets loud again. You know, that's a normal day, Reed. You know, things like that happen. But I think it's also just the creativity and engagement. You know, I can go to a dance concert here and half of the dancers are psych majors. Or I can go to Fridays at, I think it's Fridays at 4 or 5, there's our student musicians play. And you can go and it's a student you haven't seen since freshman year, but you didn't know they were a beautiful pianist. You know, that to me, I think captures it.
I like it.
Yeah, I actually discovered today in my class that a lot of, three or four students were in like bluegrass bands at Reed. I didn't know there were that many bluegrass bands, but these are all student bands. And people are really, a lot of them are really into music. So I'm proposing that at our last conference, we have a little musical session in the class and someone said they would bring like baked goods and we're gonna have a little party.
That's so fun, I wanna go. That's awesome. we've got a student that is really passionate about comparative politics, but they're a little bit intimidated about the rigor of our coursework. From your experience, Fathimath, what has helped students in your class succeed?
Well, so in our major, we first asked students to take two intro classes, right? And we see that as providing you with a really strong foundation for our upper level courses, right? So we don't really expect you to know a lot about, say, comparative politics or international relations. We start from scratch in many ways, right? So for example, in comparative politics, we'll talk about the comparative method, right? We talk about regime changes, right? Or democracies versus authoritarianism. We talk about welfare states. So we really give a good background, right, for incoming students on what comparative politics would mean in the field. And when you take that course, you'll have insight into, okay, what are some of the topics that I would like to pursue within comparative politics, right? And so based on that and where you judge your strengths to be, you will take those upper level courses. So I think our introductory classes really prepare you well for our upper levels political science courses.
And what movie would Reed be?
Oh, I was just gonna second Chris.
That's too easy.
I know. I might have more time.
Well, I'll ask Erica, then we'll let you think a little bit more. How about you, Erica? What movie?
I think mine is a little more literal than Chris's. The first thing that came to mind was I was talking with someone about how there was a film starring Harrison Ford that was filmed here, but I think that's a horror movie and I haven't seen it, but I don't think it really captures.
Thank you for not claiming that as your answer.
No. So I think to be a little more literal, the second thing that came to mind was Legally Blonde, and hear me out. So it's for folks who don't know, Legally Blonde follows Elle Woods as she goes to, I think, I want to say Harvard Law School to achieve her dreams of, well, initially to try and win back her boyfriend, but eventually to become a high-powered and very successful lawyer. And she does, I'm sorry to spoil it. I think it's been out for a while, so I feel safe doing so. But essentially what stood out to me was sort of like the combination of beautiful campus, which we certainly have in spades, and just people who are themselves out in the open and pursue what they want to pursue. I think like that's one of my favorite things about the movie is that Elle, the main character, is just doesn't care about fitting into anyone's mold of what a lawyer should look like or what this or that should be like. She just knows who she is and what she wants to do, and she is and does it. And I love that.
I love it. I am in a Legally Blonde vortex because you are probably the third or fourth person to bring up Legally Blonde in as many days as
really?
A reference for sort of like, I don't care what these people think. I'm going to do what I want to do. And I'm passionate about it. And one of them was a faculty member who said, you know, the people in my class are talking about Elle and how inspiring this person is, you know, no tongue in cheek. And so I think you'd have a lot of people who are not in their heads who would agree.
Yeah, I think not only that, but that she like has multiple sides to her and they can all coexist. That's to me is something that's quintessentially Reed student, Reed faculty, Reed community mentor, is just like having multiple passions and interests and not putting yourself in a box, letting all of those things exist together. So
being unapologetically authentic. I love it. Let's see, how about Chris, can you talk about some of the research opportunities and psychology, neuroscience? And I would just spend just a couple sentences on that and a couple sentences on the ways that someone might partner with research in psychology.
Yeah, so we have 8 faculty in the department and we are all specialists in different segments of psychology. So we have myself in clinical, we have a health psychologist, social, developmental, cognitive neuroscience and behavioral neuroscience and learning. So we have 2 faculty who work with non-human animal models in our rat colony. We have a variety of us who obviously work with humans. Some are doing more experimental type designs to understand, you know, some theory testing, hypothesis testing. Some of us are more applied. So the type of research opportunities really vary from specialty area to specialty area. But we all sort of have different groupings, I would say. There's 3 of us who do some applied work. We also do basic work, right? And so I think there's a lot of different opportunities to do things in cognitive neuroscience. We have also a great facility. So we have not only the animal colony, we have ERP labs. We also have each of us, you know, have our own laboratories so we can do our work there. And then students really get involved really from the beginning of our curriculum. We, in our introductory course, actually, very first semester at Reed, we have you working with real data and running analyses and learning basics of scientific method. And second term for majors, you take specialty 7-week courses where you're doing data collection and analysis. The class itself is generating data. So I would say, while that's not independent research, it's part of the curriculum. And then students often in the summers or as research assistants in laboratories can get involved. Clearly the senior thesis is, you know, the way in which every student has their hands in data collection and analysis. Many of us have research grants. So I have a grants from the National Institute of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism right now, a 3-year grant, we're halfway through. So I have a number of students that have been hired as research assistants who work during the school year and summer. I also take, we have competitive fellowships in the summer, both from the college and through our department. So students can be funded to do collaborative research with faculty for 10 weeks over the summer. Gosh, I think I had 6 or 7 people in my lab last summer. This year I have, right currently, 6 thesis students, 4 research assistants, and then I'll have a number of people over the summer. And I have other colleagues who have grants as well. So I think there's a lot of different opportunities for students to kind of explore. And we're always looking for more opportunities. So we have thesis students who work with partners in the community, at the medical center, at the primate center, to kind of make sure we can provide as many opportunities as we can. So does that answer your question, Lily?
Yeah, it really does. The world really is your oyster, and you've got a really nice community over with your psychology students, and they think about how the other disciplines combine. I really appreciate that. And one of the things you'll note is that research can happen at throughout your career here at Reed. You start your first year by talking with the Center for Life Beyond Reed. They're meeting with you one-on-one, talking about the different opportunities you can take advantage of. Your faculty advisors really putting things in front of you. If you want to do research, you're going to do it. And the thing about doing it at a small school is you have a greater role in everything that happens here. And I don't think folks quite understand that at a smaller school, your depth is, and your breadth and depth is much more broad and much more deep. Is that fair to say?
And if I could just comment on that, I mean, a number of times over the years, I've had thesis students leave my lab and then go to graduate school and then come back and say, I didn't really understand opportunities I had, where a PI of an NIH grant is sitting down with me weekly for an hour and a half to do my research with me. And as a graduate student, you know, you're lucky if you're working with a postdoc, you know, or you see your PI, you know, once in a while. And so I think for them, it was just sort of.
And what's a PI, Kris?
Oh, sorry, a principal investigator. So that's the person who has taken the responsibility to obtain the funding and is responsible for the research that's being conducted. And NIH is the National Institute of Health, or National Science Foundation, or these other funding agencies. So I think that just speaks to it, Milyon. I think while you're here, it's hard to recognize the benefits of being in such a small community. And I think Fatima spoke to this. I would say, like, you come into my office, I have a bulletin board and I have photographs of pretty much every senior I've had thesis student and anybody who's been a research assistant in my lab. And now I have their children on my board. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and my grand lab babies. Because it's the relationships as everybody's talked about. You know, it's not just my thesis advisor. I mean, these are relationships we have for life with our students. And I was at large research ones, maybe I knew 30 people in my lecture of 200, and I maybe really knew 2 of them, 3 of them. And I feel like I have a really long, deep family history almost with my students here.
If I can just add to that, Milyon.
Please do. And yeah. I'm also saying people are particularly curious about research in your department too.
Okay. One of the highlights for me this semester was taking one of my thesis students, also one of my advisees, out to lunch to celebrate her getting into grad school at Brown, full scholarship PhD. And the exciting thing is, you know, there's this initiative at Brown that is focused on like some of my research, like growth models. And I might get to see her when I go to Brown for a workshop in the fall, right? She's going to be there like a graduate student. So it's super exciting. Was a question specific, Milyon, about research in the department?
Right. If you could just name examples of research in political science, Kris named a long list. And what I'll tell students is these lists are equally strong in each department. This is part of what students do. So while it might not be exhaustive, I think they just want to get a quick feel of some of the type of projects you might work on or your department's worked on with students.
Okay. So we have a very strong American politics section, international relations, political economy, political theory, and comparative politics. So I work on, as I said, some of the projects that my students are working on are one on climate finance, right? So for example, how can small island developing states access climate finance for a green transition, right? So what are the some of the obstacles? What are some of the policies out there? How can we evaluate them, right? So that's one area of focus. I know that Kris works with students on how states in the US implement public policy, right? So he's really into kind of how budgets are done. He's also working on climate policy in the US. And Mariela works on abortion rights in Latin America. And I know that she's collaborated with a couple of students on that. Alex works on weapons and networks. He does a lot of network analysis. Peter does a lot of Hegel and Marx. We have faculty who are doing a variety of different things. And there's a lot of opportunities for collaboration in the department as well.
I'll answer a question really quickly. It's no more difficult for someone who's bringing in credits to take part in the senior thesis. Transfer students do senior thesis here, people bring in credit. So no worries about that. Usually it's taking care of many of your foundational courses, so you'll move into the subject area. Those conversations begin your junior year, so you've got plenty of time to sort of dig deep. Let's see, number of hours outside of class, that's really variable. What I would love for you to do is come and join a student panel to hear them talk about how they manage their coursework. And that'll give you a better idea. And no, it's not rote memorization. As we said before, it really is about conversations and not just sort of regurgitating back information. Let's see, there is one question I wanted to get to. Talked a little bit about interdisciplinary study. I apologize. While I'm looking for this, Fatima, what movie would represent Reed?
I was hoping that you've forgotten.
I know. As long as no pause.
It's not a movie, but I think maybe Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Hear me out on this one.
I love the hear me out. So that's the best one.
Not college, right? High school, but still. I think the kind of strong bonds that form between people, right? Like, you know, you have this group of best friends, and I think I see this at Reed, right? And students really form like close bonds with one another. I think these last like forever, right? I mean, these are like friendships forged in fire and sweat and blood, right? The Reed experience. So I think that they're very strong. And so just to say that people like live a very rich life. It's not all about school, right? That these bonds go beyond school, right? And on top of that, I think that there is this world-saving kind of mentality, right? Reedies think of themselves as these warriors of social justice. And I think that, that's kind of the story in Buffy too, right? And I think that you see that here as well, that students are very passionate about not just what's happening on campus, right, but about what's happening out there in the world.
And I don't think it's commentary on our dating situation on campus, by the way. Just saying. No vampire angel weirdness going on
here. You don't have any of that? Yeah. I will affirm that.
There's very little vampire dating happening on campus.
We set limits on that. I'm trying to find a good question because I can already tell that we're not going to get to every single thing that y'all are asking. These are really, really good questions. Unfortunately, we just don't have enough time. In fact, we only have about 2 minutes. And so I'm going to ask you just sort of one question that I think is, reproduces more PhDs per capita than any other school in the United States, except for three. You know, more PhDs per 100 students, except for Caltech, MIT, and we go back and forth with Swarthmore. And, you know, that's more than like Harvard, Stanford, all of these other, you know, Ivy Leagues who you'd mentioned. But y'all aren't talking about like this pressure cooker. We're talking about people sort of learning, having really deep, thoughtful conversations. How are we getting students there? And what I'll just say to folks, in order to be one of the nation's leaders, that's only about anywhere from 20 to 30% of your students who are going to get their PhD. You don't have to get your PhD to go to Reed and to be successful, but it is sort of a layman's way of saying like, hey, we're really a good school if you want to use that as a metric. But at its core, what is it that is happening for Reed students for them to be so successful in life after Reed?
I mean, to the graduate school.
This will be your closing point, so I'll have everyone respond.
I would just say, some of it's structural, right? To be honest, right? We have a qualifying exam, we have a thesis, we have, you know,
so the schools have, right?
Right. We have some experiential things that I think make people feel like, oh, I could do a PhD. Like I, even if no one in my family has done one before, I'm getting a feel for what this gig is like. Right. I also think you really should only ever go on to school past undergraduate if you're passionate and curious. And we bring people who are passionate and curious. We have fun playing with passionate and curious people. And so I think for some segment of students, they're like, man, I could sign on for more of this. This is awesome. Right. And so that's my impression. I don't think we're necessarily trying to make mini me's, but I think we have a lot of fun with what we do, and students get some examples to see of what that might be like if they choose to do that.
Yeah, and I'll just say, even if it's not a PhD, I think students are successful. What's happening here that's leading them to the success? And what I hear you saying, Kris, is this playful enjoyment of the academic discipline. It doesn't all have to be sort of like gloom and doom, head down, grind, regurgitate this. People are actually having fun learning here.
I hope so. If we're doing our, we're doing our jobs right, it should be fun.
Yeah. Erica, Fatima, what do you think?
I would say, yes, the playful part, absolutely agree with that. But it's also very rigorous, but not in the kind of like, you know, regurgitating things, but you actually, it's an intellectually rigorous place. The classes are very demanding, but I think they're ultimately very satisfying. I think students come up out of these classes feeling like they've really not only learned content, but also have developed skills, right? So in my classes, we of course like to engage with the material, and that's the primary focus, right? But equally important, I think, is that students learn these skills of, you know, thinking critically, being able to, you know, formulate opinions and talk about the content, being able to engage with one another even when they disagree. I think these are like life skills that you need, right? And I think we really focus on that at Reed to develop those skills. And that's why I think we have these, we have a center for pedagogy at Reed, right? For professors to go and always be, stay on top of what are the most innovative, useful, right? Skills that we can develop as teachers so that we can use them in the classroom to develop the skill sets of our students, right? And so I think that really helps you thrive once, you know, when you graduate from Reed, because you're graduating with not just intellectual knowledge, but also this really amazing set of skills.
Yeah, I think to pick up on threads of what other folks have been saying, which I would wholeheartedly co-sign, is essentially like part of it is I think that we just attract intellectually curious students, and hopefully that stays with them for a long time. I think that I hear too often about students sort of nationally coming out of college feeling sort of disillusioned or like there was a promise that wasn't delivered. And I think that instead that I still see that in our seniors. I still see that, like, I'm here because I love to learn. I'm so excited about, like, what's around the next corner. I'm excited to learn more than I knew yesterday. So I hope that's a sign that we're doing something right, that folks are coming in intellectually curious and they're leaving intellectually curious, you know?
Awesome. Well, I want to thank you all for really sharing your insight. It's a treat to get you all together to have these conversations. And I want to thank our students. And I see your names. I know where you're from. It's late where some of you are, or it's really early where some of you are, and you decide to spend an hour with us having this discussion. And I'll just say again, we have three more faculty spotlights, which are going to take place over the next week and a half. So come back and join us. This will be available as a recording in the future for you to take a look if you'd like to. And I'll also say that plenty of programming moving forward, both on campus and off campus, to help you figure out where your home will be for the next 4 years. Contact us if you have any questions. Fathimath, Erica, Kris, so nice to see you. Thanks for joining us.
Bye, everybody.
Bye, y'all.
Thank you. Take care, everybody.
Bye, everyone.